Mélanie Joly, welcome to Q.
Thank you. Happy to be here, Tom.
Nice to see you. So what's been going through your mind these past few months watching so many women share their stories of harassment and assault?
Well, obviously, you know, again, the cultural sector has demonstrated that they can be at the forefront of social change. Mm. Why do I say that? It's we know there has been and there is a problem with sexual harassment in workplaces. This is not new. What is new is about bringing awareness to it. Mm-hmm. And so from the Me Too movement to what has happened in Quebec with Just for Laughs, mm-hmm. or even here in the theater sector,
and Soul Pepper.
I'm happy to see that people are speaking up. Mm-hmm. Now, what do we do about it? We're now at the next phase of the movement. And so I had the chance to meet the organizations to talk about action and solutions.
So you came out of those meetings saying that cultural institutions and things your government funds could lose their funding and grants if they don't demonstrate a zero tolerance policy for harassment. How does that work?
Well, I've asked my department to look into how can we make sure to support the sector, which is really looking to basically three things. What's a model code of conduct? Mm-hmm. How can they be training and education? And also, what are the safe, not inquiries, but basically safe ways of talking about sexual harassment without fear of reprisal. Mm-hmm. So as a funder, my job, the government of Canada is a main funder for a lot of these organizations, and we want to make sure that the best practices are in place.
But how do you do that even on a small level, like a small theater company or a small ballet company? How can the government get involved there?
Well, this sector is unionized. People are represented by PACT, for example, in the theater sector, mm-hmm. or the Writers Guild, Directors Guild, the actors through ACTRA. Right. And so it's up to the unions to work with their members, and it's up to the government to partner with the unions to actually find solutions and then work with producers and work with leaders of the organizations.
I mean, but what about you, though? I mean, Me Too goes beyond the arts. I mean, you're a politician, your field.
Yeah.
I don't think it's indelicate for me to say hasn't been incredibly kind to women historically.
Mm-hmm.
Are colleagues around you in Parliament Hill talking about Me Too?
Of course.
What are they saying?
Well, I think there's kind of a aha, like finally we're talking about it.
Yeah.
Because this is happening. It is happening. It has been happening. I've been in the service sector for a long time. Before going into politics, I was in big law firms and in the communication sector. And it's about a power struggle,
yeah.
between men and women. And so I think it's just kind of being relieved of being able to talk about it. That's the first thing. Now, there is a fundamental change of culture that needs to happen, because for me, Me Too is just not something that is, stuck in time, a moment in time. It's a fundamental change of culture. It's something that will change a course of how people interact with each other.
Yeah.
And so so I'm very inspired, and I think the feminist in me is really happy this is happening, although it's been very difficult in the past months to talk about it.
But I'm guessing there have to have been times. I mean, I can even think of a couple of times I've just seen it happen publicly with you. Like, there have, mm-hmm. to have been times where people have remarked on your looks and people have remarked on you as a woman. That has to all come back too, right?
Yeah. Well, misogyny exists, Tom.
Yeah.
This is something that I have to deal with, and like all my fellow women politicians. And you know, it's sometimes very difficult. Sometimes it's frustrating.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's sad. It's not as if, you know, we don't have any emotions as human beings.
No.
But I have a feeling also that I, with all my colleagues, are creating a new generation of leadership, of women leadership, and that we're there. Well, my mother and her generation was there to trailblaze. We're doing that in another way, by allowing to talk about our emotions, by allowing to be true and authentic. And this is just another phase of really gaining gender parity.
I mean, if you're just tuning in, I'm speaking with Mélanie Joly. She's Canada's Heritage Minister. She looks after Canadian arts, culture, and media. It's a big portfolio. We're going to get you into some of the other stuff
Yep.
That's on your plate. We're catching you in the middle of awards season.
Yep.
Nominees for the Canadian Screen Awards came out on Tuesday. What are you watching these days?
Well, I've watched Elias Grace. I've watched Anne with an E.
Mm-hmm.
I'm very proud of these shows.
Mm-hmm. Not like Anne without an E.
Can't well, you know, for me, Tom, quite frankly, for me, it's Anne La Maison Pignon Vert.
Right.
It was my favorite. It's my favorite book of all time. Yeah. I was 12 years old. At the time, I didn't speak English. I read like the 8 books of the series. And I'm really, really happy to see it that it's now one of the most binge-watched show in the world on Netflix.
Are you a cord cutter? Do you watch cable?
I have cable, but I don't have a time to watch a lot of television in terms of like the appointment television. So that's why I tend to use a lot digital platforms to binge watch when I have time. And that's over Christmas, for example.
Well, and you know this leads me to what I'm going to talk about.
Of course.
You know I'm going to talk about
I'm
Netflix.
Following you, Tom.
You know what we're doing here, right? You know what we're doing.
I know where we're heading.
All right. So I want to talk about Netflix. They've agreed to put at least $500 million into original Canadian productions. You announced this last fall.
Yeah.
What's a Canadian production? What counts as a Canadian production?
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, what I'm happy with the investment in Netflix, because I guess you're referring to that as well in your question, is that there are really good series that Netflix decided to invest in. So take Elias Grace, for example. I had a good meeting with Sarah Pauly, and she was saying when thinking about how to create Elias Grace, she had a big challenge. And her challenge was what? She had to show, the fact that there was this was an immigrant family, and she had to build a ship, which is extremely costly.
Mm-hmm.
Because of the investment with Netflix, she was able actually to create the right images to tell an amazing story, to Margaret Atwood's story. And so this is the type of stories that the Netflix deal is able to showcase. So Canadian production is basically investing in Canadian stories.
But what about a show like Riverdale? Like Riverdale is an American show, but it does film in Vancouver. Does that count as a Canadian production?
So Netflix wants to do much more investments in shooting here, but they wouldn't have to do a Canadian production house to do that, quite frankly.
Yeah.
And so they decided to create a Canadian production house. That's the first time they do that outside of the US. And why would they want to do that? It's actually to make sure that there are more Canadian stories told and that they can partner with broadcasters here to make that happen.
I mean, one of the lines you hear about Canadian content, and you mentioned Canadian content a few times, is that people love the idea of it. They love the idea of supporting Canadian content. But sometimes when they go on Netflix, they'll just watch The Office, you know, or they'll watch Game of Thrones or something like that. I mean, what do you make of that?
Well, I think the bigger story is what's our relationship with digital platforms. You and I must go on our phones 150 times a day.
Yeah, I think something like that.
And so we know digital platforms are there, and so I'm concerned about the fact of how can there be Canadian content on these platforms. As a francophone, my preoccupation is how can we find French content on these platforms? How can people have access to stories that reflect where they live? And so there's no free ride for digital platforms. My expectation is that they're invest in Canadian stories, and that's why we're reviewing our entire system.
But there's no free ride. But it's also been announced that they're not going to pay sales tax on its services like broadcasters in Canada do. I mean, have you completely shut the door on that?
Well, what we've said is that we would be respecting our promise, and that's what the Prime Minister said in the election. But we know that we have to look at the contributions of digital platforms to our system.
Mm-hmm.
On a longer term.
I mean, look at the Canadian Media Fund. I mean, the Canadian Media Fund helped create shows like Kim's Convenience. I mean, don't you think Netflix should be paying into the Canadian Media Fund?
Well, right now, we don't have the levers to make that happen. And so that's why I decided to ask my team to review. We will be reviewing the Broadcasting Act and the Telecommunications Act. Ultimately, the bigger question is how can our kids have access to stories that reflect where they live, and actually that we have a common culture as a country, while they have access to a new system, which is, well, new system, a system they use more maybe sometimes than the analog one, which is the internet.
You mentioned French content. I want to ask about Quebec, but I don't think I'm going to ask the question you think I'm going to ask. you were born in. I think you've been following me along pretty good, but I think I'm following.
But I'm not always reading your mind.
you were born in Quebec. You worked in the media there. You were an intern at Radio-Canada. And your writing is there. Listen, there's been a backlash because this doesn't force Netflix to produce a specific amount of French content. I saw your appearance on Tout le monde en parle. It was rough, you know. I mean, how does it feel? And people are wearing T-shirts with your face on it. How does it feel getting that reaction from your home?
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I understand the fear of Francophones and Quebecers about the impact of this wave of American content, which is English speaking, on our culture, our French culture. I understand that the state has always been seen as the one to protect the French factor, the French fact. In French, I would say le fait français, in our country. And so that's why I've learned a lot from that. And that's why we will be working on making sure to support French content and to support actually the discoverability of French content, because this is the future of the French culture in Canada. And so, and this is, this is an issue that is not only Canadian and Quebec-based. This is an issue about cultural diversity and diversity of voices on the web. I was in Boston yesterday talking about this at the MIT lab and having good discussions even with the Harvard Research Lab on the internet. How can we not be stuck in our filter bubbles? How can, what's the social contract on the internet? What's the government's intervention on the internet? How can we keep our strong democracy? So these are fundamental questions, and we're just at the beginning of it.
So you can relate to the idea that there are no hard and fast rules about French content in this Netflix deal, and you understand there's trepidation about that.
Well, there are rules. There's a $25 million investment that Netflix needs to do to develop the market. And we expect Netflix to invest in French content. But the Netflix deal is a transition deal. It's a way for us to get money in the system while our laws and regulations need to be changed.
And you're able to not take any of this personally?
Oh, it's been, of course, I've been, sometimes it was difficult. But I've learned in politics, as a lot of people that are on, in the public scene, to differentiate my public, personality and me.
How do you do that?
I'm
asking for advice. I'm asking for advice.
Well, I'm I have the responsibility I have, and therefore, and the Prime Minister has given me this responsibility, this job. But at the same time, I have the family and the support and the friends that I've had before getting into this job.
Yeah.
And in that sense, this has been challenging, but at the same time, heartwarming, because I have, I had really, really great support back home.
I want to talk to you about Facebook, and we don't have a whole lot of time left.
Yep.
But right off the bat, though, I'm going to ask, similar to how I asked, by the way, I'm speaking with Mélanie Joly here, the Canada's Heritage Minister. How do you get your news?
Actually, a lot on my iPhone.
Yeah?
A lot on my iPhone.
From where?
I have apps, so I go on the different apps of our different media. And also, we receive paper at Heritage, so I look at that, but mainly through my iPhone, and sometimes also through Facebook and Twitter.
So Facebook is what I want to talk to you about.
Yeah.
Because not long ago, you announced that Facebook is going to start working with Ryerson University in Toronto, the brainstorming the future of news on Facebook. But then, last week, Facebook says it's going to put a bigger emphasis on posts from friends and family. All we heard in the news was that they were going to stay away from sort of news content. They were going to stay away from branded content unless it led to a greater discussion between friends and family. I think we can both agree that probably means less news on our Facebook platform. Mm-hmm. How does this square with your efforts to make Facebook the future of news?
I'm not saying that Facebook needs to be the future of news.
Do you know what I'm asking?
Yeah, I get your point. So for me, it's what's the future of the news sector? So there's two things. We reinvested in our public broadcaster, $675 million in the CBC, in order to have much more local content.
Yeah.
What I'm concerned about is the future of news in the country while there's so many newsrooms that have been cut and people losing their jobs, and especially in, you know, local news. And so I'm really looking forward to find solutions with the sector to make sure that a lot of the revenues, the advertising revenues of digital platforms can be also having a positive impact on our news sector. Because it's I think that the digital platforms have a responsibility. Like I told you, there's no free ride. How we do that, well, I'm open to discussion.
It's a funny thing, hey, because I see, and I mean this in the most gentle terms, like your government getting at least close to Netflix. You know, you're speaking with Netflix, close to Facebook. You're speaking with Facebook about news. But then, I mean, Facebook can make an announcement like this that, you know, we're going to cancel this whole news thing. They can say, hey, we're not really a media company. I mean, how does that feel working with such big companies that can be so unpredictable?
Well, you know, the private sector is the private sector.
Yeah.
And government is used to working with the private sector. But what I've learned as a minister is when the government decides to tackle an issue, there's nothing like it.
Mm.
And so this issue of dealing with digital platforms is something we will tackle.
I mean, I know a lot of people in small communities, and there's a lot of people in small communities in Canada listening to this right now who don't have, you know, local newspapers. All their news probably comes from the CBC, and the Facebook news is probably not related to stuff that's going on in their hometown.
Mm-hmm. Well, the government has always been there to make sure to support the market when there was a market failure, basically. That was the case 150 years ago when we were supporting, paying for stamps to send news to different local communities. We have a fund right now of $75 million, the periodical fund, to support local news across the country. But I'm hearing the sector about the strains they're going through, and that's something I'm working on right now.
I can tell.
No, but, you know, that's, I'm the minister, like, I'm the Canadian Heritage Minister at the time where I think we've never been so relevant as a government. The digital transformation is happening because, and affecting the cultural sector, because people go mainly on the internet to get films, to get TV, to get music. The arts is driving the development of the internet. That's the reality.
Mm-hmm.
But and news, of course. And that's why this is a difficult job, but I feel I'm on a mission to preserve and protect Canadian content.
Are you ever wistful? Or like, I could have been Canadian Heritage Minister when everyone was watching TV and there was no internet, you know? That would have been all right.
No, well, there's always been some issues. Sheila Copps went through the magazines war at the time.
There was the great carrier pigeon debate of 1923. Remember that? Remember Louis Saint Laurent getting involved in that?
I don't remember that in particular, but what I remember, though, is it's always been part of our national narrative to be close to the U.S. Maybe you're Francophone or you be just English-speaking Canadian.
Mm-hmm.
And what we decided 75 years ago, Tom, it was to make sure that we would keep our sovereignty on the airwaves. Mm-hmm. That's why we created the CBC. And it was R.B. Bennett creating that in the 30s.
Mm-hmm.
Then afterwards, we created the NFB. Then the CRTC came up. And afterwards, the Canadian content rules. So we've always been there to protect our culture. We are a minority as a country in an English-speaking, continent when you look at it. And so next to the biggest exporter of content in the world. And so that's why there is a minister of Canadian heritage. Mm. I don't have a counterpart in the U.S., for example. And that's why we need to adapt our system to make sure that it's relevant in a digital age, because the principles we had, or we have actually in the analog world, are still principles in which we believe and that are important for the sector.
I mean, it is tough because when I was a kid, I would turn on the radio and I would hear a certain amount of Canadian music. And that was kind of all I could hear, you know, and I would go on Much Music and I would watch, you know, whatever was on and I'd watch a bunch of Canadian music and it really informed my life. But now on Spotify, I can really kind of listen to whatever I want to. There's no one really forcing me to listen to anything.
Yeah, well, it's an open system. Yeah. There are good Canadian lists, music lists. And I had some good conversations with Spotify. But this is a question that ministers of culture around the world are asking themselves, how to deal with this. And that's why I'm saying this is the beginning of the conversation. But ultimately, I think also, I'm there at the moment where Canada's artistic sector and Canada's brand has never been as strong, from Rubik Kaur mm-hmm. to Denis Villeneuve and Jean-Marc Vallée and Xavier Dolan. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we have so many great musicians and so many great filmmakers. I'm proud of that. But these artists are able to flourish internationally because they were able to have access to a support system, maybe from the Canada Council for the Arts, maybe through Telefilm, or actually the Canada Media Fund. And that is fundamental, and these different agencies and organizations need to adapt their policies to the digital reality.
That's nice to hear you say talk that way about the Canada Media Fund. You're going to be at the Junos?
Of course I'll be there, for sure.
Well, we'll see you there.
So you will be there for sure?
I mean, I think it's a bit of a secret. Is it a bit of a secret that I'm going? I don't know. I'm probably going to get in trouble. Sure. Yeah, I'll be at the Junos.
See you then.
Thanks for coming in.
Thank you, Don.
Melanie, don't be a stranger. Don't let it be so long next time.
Okay, for sure. All right. We'll be back.